Good morning, my dear students. And once again, I welcome you all first to e-Sikshana program. Myself, Dr. Nagaraj A.M., Principal, Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Technology, Bangalore. So my mobile number and email ID, you have to note down. For any clarification, you can please contact on this number. For any questions related to heat transfer subject, you can contact to this number. Okay. The last time, e-Sikshana 1 program, I delivered advanced applied thermodynamics. This time, I am taking the heat transfer. This is for 6th semester students. Coming to the subject module 1, the first our lecture. Syllabus, first I would like to give the more information regarding related to the syllabus coverage. For 50 hours, see the module 1 consisting of the introductory concept, definition, modes of heat transfer, basic law governing conduction, convection and radiation, and related properties of the material and boundary conditions, and how the general heat conduction equation is formulated, and derivation of equation for study one-dimensional heat conduction, especially in Cartesian coordinate and cylindrical coordinate and spherical coordinate. See, I appeal to all the students, those who are taking this subject for the first time, that is in 6th semester, don't feel that this subject is a very tough subject. But it is very difficult to analyze any subject unless you go through the content very seriously. And the basics of thermodynamics, because it is very difficult to analyze the heat transfer by applying thermodynamics law and principles. That is why it is extended subject of thermodynamics only. Again, it is going to be subject of mathematics. And you know that you already studied in mathematics the differential mathematics, integration, differentiation, all those equations you are using. It means extensively you have to apply your mind to understand the differential equation statements, how the first order differential equation, second order differential equation may be useful for different various cases that you are going to apply. This is the module 1, and which covers broadly on conduction, convection and radiation, the basic principles that are going to be covered. And the module 2 is also again a conduction, extension of conduction subject only. It also applied to the extended portion of conduction for the application, that is how the extended surface are to be applied with the heat transfer, and how the heat transfer coefficient to be applied, and some of the system efficiency and their effectiveness with the transient heat conduction, with the negligible internal resistance, thermal resistance we call it as, and the surface resistance, those things you are going to study at large in this module 2. This is for 10 hours, and module 3 is covering most of them free convection and convection related, with most theory of velocity and thermal boundary layers. Already you studied this fluid boundary layers in fluid mechanics, and also you are using non-dimensional analysis also here to group the non-dimensional numbers, and this is one of the mathematical tool for analyzing the heat transfer subject. So there you have studied only the fluid boundary as a subject of interest, how the velocity profile is varied. Here, clubbing two, those one is a thermal boundary layer as well as fluid boundary layer we are considering for analyzing the heat transfer problem, how the heat is getting transferred from surface to the fluid that you are going to analyze. There also you are going to study for all the objects, that is a flat surface, cylindrical surface and also spherical surfaces, using the Navier-Stokes equation, how the equation is derived and how you are going to apply those equations for analyzing the fluid as a media to carry the heat transfer, heat from one media to other media, and that can be analyzed here. See, we're more interested in analytical solutions here, then we are not interested in solving these problems by analytical solutions. We are using, most of them are empirical in nature. That is a mathematical tool that you are using to solve this problem. See, analytical solutions, if you take, it has become more complex and it's very difficult to solve those problems. Either you go for any one of the tool which is easy for us. Now, we are usually in heat transfer, you are going to use the empirical relations for solving these problems. So that is covered extensively in module 3, and module 4 is the radiation. It means there is a conduction, convection and radiation. Module 4 is a fundamental principle of radiation, how the radiation is applied with the temperature difference. There are many, many type of radiations are there. Electromagnetic wave radiation is there, and radio frequency is there. These are comes under different bandwidth of radiation, but we are interested between 0.4 to 4 micrometer wavelength. Those are treated as radiations, thermal radiations. This is the chapter 4, that means module 4, which covers again a 10-hour class. The last module, which covers the heat exchangers, the definition and number of transfer units, the method applied, how to calculate the fouling factors, and many different charts are used to calculate the heat transfer coefficient in heat exchanger, and design of heat exchanger, effectiveness, and phase change, how this is going to be applied in boiling and condensation, and how bubbling growth occurs, how the nucleate pool boiling is there, all those things they are going to study. And these are the principle applied for almost all in boiler applications and radiator applications that you are going to use. So the here, the broadly it covers, these modules are covered by 10 hours each, and total number of hours which you are going to cover it up in 50 hours. So where I am going to cover up the conduction portion, that is module 1 and module 2 for you, and the rest another 3 teachers are there to go ahead with the module 3, module 4 and module 5. So textbooks for reference, and this is the prescribed textbooks from the university for the syllabus coverage. Principle of heat transfer, Prankrit, Raj M, Mangalik, Mark, S. Bohan, 7th edition. This is Sanjay's Learning 2011 book, is available in almost all libraries. You can refer this. This is extensively covering the conduction portion of the topic. Yunus and Senegal, Heat Transfer Practical Approach, 5th edition, Tata McGrail, which also covers conduction as well as convection topics. J.P. Hallman and Bhattacharya, 10th edition, McGrail, this also covers extensively about convection and radiation topics. So the other reference subjects also given. Here the one important thing is, second one, the reference subject, but book which I am telling, extensively used by most of the professors for covering the heat transfer. That is Heat Transfer by Nakati Vajasik, A Basic Approach, McGraw-Hill, New York 2005. It is available, and in the library also it is available. You can also take it, and then extensively you study this. This gives a wonderful insight or the reference to the heat transfer related problems. And other subjects, other reference books which are given are similar in nature, but it depends on how you are going to study extensively. In-depth knowledge you want to gain, you have to refer all these books and then study well. So the e-books or web reference is also available, and on Google, NPTEL heat transfer courses also for mechanical engineers available, and other MOOC and Moodle subjects. You can also refer online MySU online course subjects for your in-depth knowledge. So these are the some of the abbreviation that I am going to use in the subject to cover up. When I write the equation, you should have a knowledge about the what is area, what is AC, cross-sectional area, like that. You're using some abbreviations. These abbreviations very much referred with their units and the quantity that to be compared and symbols to be used. These one should be familiar while writing an equation, and the unit is very important. Any write any equations that should be, you should understand first the what is the N stand for, what this is newtons and the force, and similarly the Fourier number is a non-dimensional number, frictional it has no unit for that. Grassof number is also non-dimensional, that is why there is no unit. So similarly, other units are also given in this abbreviations that I am going to use at taking the classes, and these are the some more abbreviation that I am going to use. So this is the Greek letters, the special abbreviations that you are going to apply. All those things you have to refer very carefully. So they coming to the topic of interest, the first module, that is introductory concept and definitions. So that I am going to use if any the complicated equations are there, I am going to use this board. I am going to write here. This is the first class I am going to write, because heat transfer subject actually to be taught on board by writing equations, and the student will have better understanding. If I write equation, they able to see what I am writing there and what are things to be covered. But possibly I am going to explain all that in a slide, and also some of the equations, complex equation, I am going to simplify on board to make you understand better. Okay, so the first topic of module 1, the first class that I am going to take, introductory concept and definitions. What is introductory concepts that you are going to deal with, and definitions. The study of heat transfer mechanism is very important for engineering, who is the field of design, construction, testing and operation, and other heat exchanger equipments. Already explained in the syllabus content that these are the field of interest that we are going to cover it up. So in mechanical engineer, that also deals with the IC engines, steam generation and refrigeration, air conditioning systems. Chemical engineer also, they will refer this heat transfer for condensation, melting and cooking of fluids, because of various process industries, they adopt heat transfer technique in order to conserve the energy, because the energy wasted is again, it cost their economics to be worked out. If you save that energy wastage, you can also save the money also. This is how the civil engineer also deals with heat transfer during construction of a dam, because the concrete, once it is mixed and then poured, they generate a lot of heat, and there also the heat transfer is plays a very dominant role, and in structures and buildings. These are the some of the field of and electrical engineer, they apply the knowledge of designing the transformer, motors, cooling of motors, DC shunt motor, generator, and there also they use some fluids that can be used for cooling the big transformers, which are step down transformer or step up transformer. There also using fluid that is called the coolant that we are using. And the construction engineers, most of them are especially they are interested in dam structures and buildings, in understanding the heat generated, how it is could be cooled and what is the time, retention time for cooling, and how fast you can cast the slab, whether it is possible to dump all the concrete at one location or how they are going to, these are all depend on the design engineer gives the variables how to handle this situation. The knowledge of heat transfer for very much required for almost all engineers, whether it is a mechanical engineer or a civil engineer or a chemical engineer or electrical engineer, even electronics engineer also, they need to have a knowledge of, because whatever you take, one form of energy is converted to another form. See, the electronics engineer, where do they come across this type of heat transfer is that when the circuit is designed, there also the energy going in a different form, one form to other form. There it generates a lot of energy. Energy is generated that if it is not dissipated properly by through the convection mode or radiation mode or conduction mode, then the performance of those system going to be deteriorated. That is why heat removal is the, you must have seen that in computers. The CPU is loaded with a motor on the top of it, because it generates a lot of heat, that should be properly taken out. And there was small blower or small fan is fitted on that CPU unit itself. So that is how the, and also the fins which are on power electronics, you know that any integrated circuit or transistor that you are going to be loaded on the circuit, it is having a lot of fins on that. How the fins are designed to dissipate the energy generated. These are the some of the application that we are going to talk about. See, the this gives the successful operation of components and turbine. See, suppose if you take example of refrigerator, heat exchanger, you know that boilers, these are all one form of energy converted into another form and then taken into, first in the boiler if you take, water is getting heated up, converted into steam, steam is carried to a heat exchanger. Most of the rice mills, they are using this steam for cooking the rice. It means you call it as the steaming of rice. Once the steamed rice, you know, market is very well, you know that steamed rice is available, raw rice is available. The why the nomenclature is given is the steamed rice is much cheaper, and they are grown immediately after the harvesting. They immediately bring to the mills and then they'll convert it into rice and then supply to the market for it. That is why it costs less. The raw rice is, you'll have to wait for seasoning. After that, there's going to be milled and then rice is supplied. That is why it costs more. And what is the technical technology in that is that cooked rice is not feasible, because it is everything is done at a very faster rate in order to give it for consumption, and it never allow for seasoning also. That is not good for health. That is the one condition. I know it depends on the user. That is a different issue. There they are using a boiler. Boiler is used to convert the water to steam. Steam is used for cooking that to a certain extent. After that, it become easy for them to polish the rice and then take out the husk from the rice paddy, and then it can be processed further. See, the successful operation of turbine blades and gas turbines and IC engines, this also plays a dominant role. You know, everybody familiar with IC engines. Most of the, you must have seen internal combustion engines, means the cars, trucks, bus, even the locomotives, even big earth movers are loaded with internal combustion engines, where the fuel is burnt as a source of energy, and the heat energy is created inside the combustion chamber. When the heat energy is there, it is bound to transfer to the wall, and then it is getting heated up, walls are getting heated up, and thereby the power generated inside combustion chamber used for useful work. Whatever the heat energy generated, it should be properly dissipated out. Otherwise, the metallurgical condition plays a dominant role in deciding the performance of an IC engine. This is one of the facts. It means what you understand from this, all this is, heat should be properly dissipated. And what mode? It is in the conduction mode or convection mode or radiation mode. Whatever mode you need to have, depend on the situation and circumstances and the design of these components to be very well addressed by this subject. So this is how we have to. So there's some more details given the how the civil engineer deals and electrical engineer deals. You can also refer this. See, the best example show the almost all branch of engineering is covered, and the heat transfer problems are encountered which cannot be solved by simple thermodynamics reasoning alone, but it requires analysis based on the science of heat transfer. This is most important. I'll repeat once again, the many practical problem encountered, it cannot be solved in heat transfer area. That is, by giving some reasoning in thermodynamics, it cannot be solved alone. So you need to have a science of heat transfer. So in that context, I am going to take it as the basic modes of heat transfer. You know that heat transfer can be defined as the transfer of energy from one region to the another region as a result of temperature difference between them. It's very simple to define the heat transfer. You know how the heat is transferred. The best example I can quote, whenever you hold a on your finger and simple length rod like this. This is a rod, okay, metal rod. If you heat the one end of the rod, you may experience after a certain period of time the heat is transferred to your finger, that you are where you are holding it. It takes some time to transfer because it means that the heat transfer can one region to the another region. It means this is the one region, this is another region. In a boundary, this is the boundary. Treat it as this is a boundary. One region to another region, the heat is getting transferred. See, as a result of what? As a result of temperature difference. This is higher temperature, this is lower temperature. It means because of this high temperature, the temperature start moving in this direction. Finally, it touches your finger. You feel it, that heat is coming out. So this phenomenon of heat transfer is universal, as those associated with the gravitational attraction. Since the difference in temperature exists all over the universe, it means how the wind is blows, it is because of temperature difference. And how the swirl occurs, it is because of temperature. And all those things, all the change in phenomena on the earth surface also occurs because of continuous heating, continuous cooling, and intermittent of those two. It means this whole universe is driven by the heat transfer only. It means one form or the other form, the heat is going to be main responsible component for change in the atmospheric condition. So there are three different modes of heat transfer broadly we are classifying. One is conduction, another is convection, and third one is radiation. I'll repeat once again. There are three different modes of heat transfer. First one is conduction, second one is convection, and third one is radiation. See, I'll draw the student attention that all the three modes of heat transfer have a common difference. What is that common difference? Is the temperature difference. Even the conduction occurs also, it should have possess some common difference, that is the temperature common difference is that. See, if there is no temperature gradient or difference is not there, then there is no flow. It means water flows from high gradient to the low gradient. It means water flows from which direction it flowing. Usually you must have seen it flows in the direction of north only, all the water. It means usually rivers are in that direction. So why it is because by nature or because of gravitational attraction, we don't know. It is a nature. And similarly, the temperature gradient, the lower the temperature gradient, higher temperature gradient, lower temperature gradient, heat will flow, energy will flow. It is a phenomena of nature. Okay. So all the three modes of heat transfer have a common, that is temperature difference must exist, and that there is a transfer in the direction of decreasing temperature gradient. That is what the definition. See, the conduction heat transfer is to be studied, and there is a governing law which governed by the phenomenon of conduction, named after a French mathematician, Joseph Fourier, and is popularly known as Fourier's law of conduction. So the Joseph Fourier, he is a mathematician, a French mathematician. He has derived this. You know, the heat transfer, most of the research going on in mathematics, those who are having a degree, PhD degree in mathematics, they come to heat transfer or fluid mechanics, one or the other, they are taking the degree, their doctoral degree completed in these subjects. So that is why the French mathematician is the one, again I am quoting this, and he is a mathematics man. He has given a lot of equations and helpful for how to devise a system by using these formulas. The Fourier law of conduction states that there is a rate of heat transfer or heat flow by conduction in a given direction is proportional to the area perpendicular to the direction of heat transfer and the temperature gradient in that direction, and is given by, I am going to write that equation. So therefore Q is equal to minus K A dT by dx. You know, thus this equation, you call this equation 1, where heat transfer, this conduction heat transfer in a given direction, it is proportional to, if you take equation, if you take this proportionality constant, this term after that will take it. Conduction heat transfer is proportional to the area exposed normal to the direction of heat flow multiplied by the temperature gradient. Are you following? The rate of heat flow is proportional to the area exposed perpendicular to the direction of heat transfer, area exposed perpendicular to the direction of heat transfer. You know, suppose if this slab is there, area exposed perpendicular to the direction of, this is the direction of heat flow, heat is coming from some direction, and this is the area exposed direct perpendicular to the direction of heat flow, and also there should be a temperature difference, this is the temperature difference and this is temperature T2, it should exist at two different temperatures, the direction and temperature gradient exists in that direction, in this direction only temperature gradient exists, then only this, the Fourier's law of thermal conduction is holds good. So he has introduced the proportionality constant after that. So what is that proportionality constant is introduced? K is equal to minus K is the proportionality constant is introduced. After that, the whatever is there, A into dT by dx is written. See, Q is equal to minus K dT by dx. It should multiply by A. And this should be in watts per meter square. The unit is watt per meter square. Watt is the energy and area. Per meter square area, how much energy is getting transferred from one direction to the other direction? Probably you may indicate that this is the direction which is going. Okay? So, coming to the next slide that I am going to flash quickly. So, the that is Q is equal to minus Ka dT by dx, the equation 1.1. You see the graph which I have shown there on the right side of the right side of me, that is a graph is there. That is the temperature versus the distance x I written on graph there. And that rectangular object which indicates the slab, that is wall you can get, cross section of the wall you have taken. The temperature T1 and T2, at two locations I mentioned temperature T1. It means if you this is the cross section of the wall, the this is how the heat will flow, this is at temperature T1, this is at temperature T2, and this one is, we call it as dx, and this temperature difference you call it as dT. So the slope of this curve we will call it as dx by dt. This is dx and this is dt. Slope is multiplied by that. So now what is that? As for the definition, this is how the heat will flow through the wall. So in the direction x, and dt by dx is the slope that you are going to give. Why K is taken as negative? And you may ask question, why K is marked as negative there? it is in the positive direction of x, k, that is temperature decreases. In the positive direction of x, temperature decreases. That is, k only, minus k you have taken. It means decreasing means energy is dissipated from one system to the other system through a wall. It means the loss. Loss is, it means according to thermodynamics, you have to take it as a negative sign. Okay, energy is dissipated from system to the surrounding. In the above equation, negative sign indicates the temperature decreases along the positive direction of x. Thermal conductivity of material is expressed. So, where k is the thermal conductivity of the material. So, from this equation, q is equal to minus k dt by dx. This is watts only. A is unit area I am taken. Unit area taken. A is 1 only. So, that is, if you consider that k is equal to minus q by dt by dx, this is watt per meter Kelvin. So, and this is the unit for that. Q is the, if you are considering the unit area, and it can be meter Kelvin only you will get. If it is a q is taken, small q is taken, if you are considering area, capital Q by A, dt by dx, again you have to write one more step, again it is extended, small q is the heat flux that you are going to use. This is watts per meter square again, sorry, watt per meter Kelvin, if you are using q as a. So, this is very simple equation. If you remember, q is equal to minus k a dt by dx, you can convert it to any other form you want. Okay. See, the thermal conductivity has the highest value, highly conducting pure metals, such as which is the highly conducting pure metal is the copper, and has the lowest value of gases and vapors, except the vacuum. Evacuated insulated system, it means the vacuum, your thermal flask is the one best example for that. Conducting non-metallic solids like liquid lies between them, because the conduction of non-conducting metallic and solids are lies between the liquid and gas. See, the copper has got the highest conductivity. The thermal conductivity also varies with the temperature difference. It means if the temperature increases, the thermal conductivity also going to be varied. That is why the metals conduct electricity and heat also. The value is negligible. Some material over the certain temperature range, it means the conduction value is highly negligible because of the their property. And conduction very significantly depends the material and the situation and applied temperature also. So, those material properties that we are going to study by seeing the table here, you know, I take an effort to explain the thermal conductivity of various the engineering materials that are shown on the block diagram with the X on the range of thermal conducting materials that in the X direction. And in the y direction, I have shown the conductivity range. You know, the highest conductivity is for noble metals like silver, gold, and platinum. And the highest is copper. Thermal conductivity is very high for copper, low for steel. And you know, other liquid metals are there, sodium, mercury. Sodium has got higher range compared to mercury. The plastic and woods are the lowest and oxides are the highest. And oils are having a very low thermal conductivity and water is having a very high thermal conductivity. Similarly, fibers and foams, you know, bed foams and sofa set foams are used. Those are very low thermal conductivity and fibers are having a very compared to the foams, but height of thermal conductivity. Similarly, gases, carbon monoxide and helium and hydrogen are at air thermal conductivity. Some other engineering materials like that you can count. that is ceramics are there and other materials. They have got very low thermal conductivity. Refractory bricks that you are using in boiler, those are having very low thermal conductivity. That is why they are using, they are all used for cladding purpose, and also the refractory bricks were used for boilers where the iron is going to be melt and it has to withstand very high temperature. So these are the some of the thermal conductivity, and that is the property of material. So what is convection heat transfer? The convection heat transfer, this heat transfer takes place between two regions, that is higher region of temperature to lower region of temperature, due to the molecular motion and macroscopic motion of fluid particles. Molecular motion means the air molecules are there, gas molecules are there. They are near the wall, they accumulate heat and then they transfer. You must have seen that whenever you walk on in summer in the desert place where you get very hot air blowing from one direction to other direction, you feel it, isn't it? That is, the temperature of the air is getting increased. How it gains the heat? First it get conducted and then convected to the air through molecular motion. And that is in large quantity, large molecules, that is called, we call it as macroscopic motion of fluid particles. Macro means large quantity. So the convection heat transfer is further classified into free convection or natural convection and forced convection. So already we studied conduction. Convection is applicable to only to the fluid and air. Even mercury is also taken for convection application. Sodium is also taken for convection application. They are the liquid metals that we are going to consider. So if the mixing motion takes place because of the region that whenever you heat the fluid, there causes a density difference. It means when the fluid is getting heated up, it loses its density. It becomes lighter in weight and then start moving. So the best example that I can quote is when you are heating the fluid in a container consisting of, container, it means vessel you can consider, and consisting of water that you are putting on a stove, start heating it. So then the heat will transfer from bottom surface to the top surface through convection process. It means it circulates from the wall to the center to the wall, it circulates in the reverse direction. Same as the case, if you heat from the, you keep the vessel like this, water you keep it in the vessel, okay, instead of heating at the bottom, you heat it from the top. It never, the bottom water never get heated up because the water is there. The surface is only getting heated up, only the surface layer, one layer of the water is getting heated up and rest all remain cold. It won't transfer heat because there is no convection current. When it happens, convection current is when the liquid is getting heated up at the bottom, the molecules which are near the vicinity of the base of this vessel, they get heat conducted and then they move up. Because of loss of density, they'll move up and the high density molecules move down, thereby set in a current of circulation. It means from top to bottom, it's keep revolving. Finally, you may see the water is boiling. It means at the center, what get boiled? It is because continuously the water is getting heated at the bottom and then thrown to the top. Thereby, the center you'll get the bubbles and it goes to the wall side and getting cooled and then it goes down there. This is called the convection current, natural convection current, you call it as. These are there also the temperature gradient exists. The process is known as natural convection. What is the forced convection? The forced convection is one, the mixed motion occurs by external means. It means you have to put some spoon or some stick to stir it up. Then it enhances the heat transfer value, and it similarly the air is also getting it up even if you are mixing it. You have to use a blower, pump or any means to disturb that natural convection. Then it becomes forced convection. It means The mixing motion is induced by some external means such as pumps, blowers, then process is known as heat transfer by forced convection. Any system you have to induce this. The effective transformation of this energy by mode is merely dependent on nature as well as the mixing of fluid. If the wind is blowing from one direction or another direction, there is a mixing motion occurs. That is why the heat is carried. So when you are sitting in a room, when you go out, after a long time you go out, you will experience a different temperature because there is a mixing motion is there. That is a forced convection. Therefore, the knowledge of characteristic of fluid, remember this, I am repeatedly telling you, the knowledge of characteristics of fluid and fluid flow is necessary to study the heat transfer phenomena by convection. It means you will have to understand three things. One is knowledge of temperature difference, knowledge of fluid characteristics, and also the phenomena of convection. Convection is a property of fluid. So that three things you have to understand, and that you have to study by free convection as well or natural convection as forced convection. This is another topic, another mode of heat transfer that you are talking about. See, coming to the last mode of heat transfer, this is one example I gave. Let us consider a plate having a temperature. This I am going to explain. Consider a plate which is having a wall temperature TW and the free stream temperature is T infinity. Here I have shown T infinity. So, there the velocity profile and temperature profile I plotted for the convection heat transfer from heated surface. It means if the surface is getting heated up here, means Q is added up here. Heat flux is added up. Heat flux means some heating coil is there. Imagine there is a heating coil on the bottom of the plate, flat plate. So to say, I can write here and then show you what is the flat plate looks for. You know the table top you have seen, no? That itself is treated as a flat plate. Open the table top and that become a wall, this one plate, and it is having certain thickness and larger in length. Okay. It has got three dimensional object property. One is thickness, length and breadth. So here I have thickness and length I have shown, not the breadth I have not shown. Breadth is perpendicular to the board. I think why I am telling you this is, I am going to write one slab here. This is a three-dimensional object I am just writing. So this is what I have shown. Hatched portion which I have shown. If you are looking from the front, you can be able to see this. This is a slab of thickness T. Right? And that is I have shown. The heat is supplied like this. From the bottom, heat is supplied. Breadth is now perpendicular to the board. Okay, the fluid flow is shown. Fluid flow is shown by these lines. That is a common magnitude lines which are shown. The left extreme of that is the free stream flow. Free stream means it has no objection and there is no obstacles. Freely it is flowing. When it touches the surface, because of the surface friction on the top, the velocity gradient decreases. It becomes zero, almost zero. There is no flow of fluid particles and at the surface. That is why the velocity keep on increasing as you go to the free stream. As you go to the free stream like this. Okay. So, it becomes U infinity at the top. So here I am going to plot the velocity. So this is how I am going to plot. Here u is equal to 0. Here u infinity. It means free stream velocity. Here t infinity and this is tw. The heat is supplied here q. So this is the velocity profile. Already studied in fluid mechanics and fluid flows and that. And you know that the temperature profile will be like this. Temperature keep on increasing or decreasing as you go up. The wall temperature is more at the bottom. The air temperature is low at the top. There should be a temperature difference. That is hot plate. It's having more hotness here and less hot here because this is the temperature profile which I plotted. It means temperature keep on increasing as you go below. That is why this is the magnitude that I am showing. Magnitude as well as the direction. This is magnitude as well as the direction which I am showing. So this is how the Where is it? You might have started again. Class start again. Start again. What is it? Okay, John. Sorry for the disturbance. So now the I'll take a break 1 minute. Sorry for the break. I'll continue. See, this is the velocity profile and temperature. There are two profiles are they given. Okay, this is how the concept of heat transfer by convection was introduced by Newton's in 1701. He recommended the following equation to take into account the heat flow from solid surface to the fluid. You please note that Q is a conduction heat transfer. And to the left side of the equation, to the right side of the equation is a convection equation. So the conduction is equal to the convection. It means he recommends the following equation. Q is equal to A into H into delta T. Delta T is the temperature difference. In conduction, you return dt by dx. How you return the slope? Dt by dx. Here you have to find the temperature difference. And there should be a gradient. That is called a difference. So you know that what is that difference you call it as? A is the area. It means it is not cross-sectional area. It is the area which you are going to consider. It means the square the area. The exposed area, normally the direction of heat flow. And H is the heat transfer coefficient. And T is the wall is the highest temperature. Minus T infinity is the air temperature. So the wall temperature expressed in degree Celsius. Huh? Yeah, ma'am. So TW is the wall temperature and T infinity is the air temperature. Why you are giving T infinity means? The T infinity means anywhere away from the surface is called T infinity. Away from the surface is called T infinity. That is the air temperature, free air temperature you call it as, expressed in degree Celsius. Here we are not using absolute temperature. Where in thermodynamics calculations you are using absolute temperatures. Similarly, you should not use absolute temperature as actual temperature, whatever is there, you can substitute and calculate the property. Okay? See the conductivity, I am going to write here, K value conductivity is watt per meter degree or meter Kelvin. And H value, where heat transfer coefficient value is watt per meter square Kelvin. This you have to remember. And A is the area is in meter square. TW is in degree Celsius and T infinity is also in degree Celsius and Q is in watt per meter square. So these are the some of the units that you are going to use and already explained there. And another condition that you did, we have to prove really the definition of H rather than the law. Under steady heat transfer flow conditions, what is that? Heat is conducted is equal to heat convected from the solid boundary to the adjacent fluid layers. So the Q is equal to HA delta T. That is the definition of Newton's law definition that he has given. According to that, you can substitute the value. Q value you can substitute in this equation. Q is equal to minus KA dT by dx at x is equal to L. See the the boundary limit that I am giving, x is equal to L, x is equal to L is the conduction, x may be, the limit is x may be 0 to L. So it means wall temperature from starting from 0 to L, you can also take it as. That whenever I write that boundary condition x is equal to L, you have to remember x varies from 0 to limit L. So, and that is equated to convection heat transfer. You know that by substituting these two equations, I can draw your attention that equation 1.4 is the heat transfer coefficient. You've seen that from the equation, the system with the wall temperature TW and fluid temperature T infinity, knowing the thermal conductivity of the material, and you can calculate the heat exchange, heat transfer coefficient with a known temperature difference dT by dx at x is equal to L, and also the fluid temperature difference. Fundamentally, we call it as a dT by dx is a slope of the conducting material in the decreasing direction, and TW minus T infinity taken as that the fluid temperature difference between the wall and the fluid. Okay, this is how the convection equation goes. See, coming to the radiation heat transfer quickly, radiation is the process by which the flow of high temperature, flow, it means radiation heat flows from high temperature body to the body at low temperature, and these bodies are kept separately in space even when vacuum exists between them. It means, see, you must have, best example is that whenever the person is suffering from fever and is running out some disease, he may rise, his body temperature increases. When you go to him, you will experience that as if you are receiving heat from him, his body to you. The another example, best example to quote is that whenever you go before and stand the burning objects, or the, when the flame is there, you stand before, away from the flame also, you will receive some heat. How this heat is received or experienced by you people? It is by radiation only. The another example is that the incandescent light, not tube light or LED lights, they never emit so much radiation. So the incandescent or lamp, if you consider Bunsen burner, it is also a lamp, or the wax lamp. So the usually we are using wax or Petromax or the kerosene lamps that emits lot of carbon dioxide. That carbon dioxide glows well when it is burning, and it releases light energy and also the heat energy. So this heat energy you are going to experience when you sit near to that, and you experience by radiation. It means even the two objects kept apart in the vacuum or in a space, they experience exchange of heat between them. Okay, same thing happening between sun and earth. It is by radiation. That is, what type of radiation is that? First, infrared radiation, just thermal radiation, or solar radiation, what radiation you call it as? We'll discuss, depend on the wavelength, you are going to discuss that. So we are interested only in radiation energy transmitted through space, and you know that between sun and earth there is a vacuum exists. Still the radiation occurs, and how it is possible that you are going to, this is very complex phenomena. Thermal radiation is a very complex subject, but it is not yet defined properly. How the energy is transmitted is only a postulation, that we are assumption, we are making some assumptions. It means we are saying this, okay, this may be correct, this may not be correct, like that. That is a, we call it as a radiation heat transfer is a postulation. So the energy transmitted in this manner is termed as radiation. Why in this term manner in termed as a radiation heat transfer? Because there exists a temperature difference between the space. So the, how the, as I quoted already, that person who is suffering from fever is because more temperature is there in the body, he start emitting continuously the energy in the form of some form of energy that is coming out from his body in a particular wavelength that is sensed by other person who is having less temperature. That is called, the energy emitted is called thermal radiation. The radiation energy emitted by the body is transmitted in a space is in the form of electromagnetic waves as per the Maxwell's electromagnetic wave theory, or in the form of discrete photons as per the Planck hypothesis. There are two hypotheses. One is electromagnetic waves as per the Maxwell electromagnetic wave theory. Another one is discrete photon as a Planck's hypothesis. It means hypothesis of Planck says that the photons are emitted by the sun and they are carriers of energy. They come and strike the human body. Thereby, the energy gets absorbed to your body and you will experience some radiation heat. When you stand in the sun during afternoon, you may experience, you may call it as a, oh, what a scorching sun, and I am experiencing a lot of heat. If you wear black body and then stand, that black means black shirt, colored shirt, black colored shirt. If in a white, that reflects in a black colored shirt, keep absorbing all the heat energy, not radiation I am talking about, heat energy, it absorbs very fast, getting heated up. It is by the discrete photon movement from sun to the earth. See, the thermodynamic consideration shows that the ideal thermal radiator or a black body will emit energy at rate proportional to the fourth power of absolute temperature of the body, directly proportional to the surface exposed normal to the direction. This is always the definition that I am going to give you. See, thermal energy emitted, that I am going to give you is thermal energy. Radiation of the black body is proportional to the fourth power of the temperature, absolute temperature. Here we are getting absolute temperature, remember, and directly proportional to the surface area exposed. So this is what the equation, this is known as the Stefan-Boltzmann law of radiation, and is applied to only black body. What do you mean by black body? Does it looks black to your eye and then you can say there is a black body? No, not like that. Looking black is something else. Even the ice is a black body to the radiation. You know ice cube? Ice cube is a black body. For radiation I am talking about, not for a looking bare eye. When you experience the eye may defeat you in understanding whether it is a black body or white body. The body which absorbs all radiation emitted by another body, it is called a black body. BLACK, not BLOCK, black body. The maximum energy emitted by a black body at a temperature T is given by EB, is the energy emitted by or absorbed by the black body, is a sigma times T to the power of 4, sigma times T to the power of 4 in watts per meter square. This is energy, again energy emitted by the body, that your in conduction you have used it as a Q. And in thermal radiation, sorry, in convection used as a Q is equal to HA delta T, TW minus T infinity. Same way here also, instead of EB, it means energy emitted. You cannot call it conducted or transmitted by convection. It is EB, the different notation that you use. EB is the black body emissive power. That is energy emissive power of that black body. It emits so much of energy from one direction to the other direction. Where sigma is the Stefan-Boltzmann constant and it's equal to 5.66 97 into 10 raised to -8, I think, watts per meter square Kelvin to the power of 4. This radiation energy emitted in the real body is always less than that of the black body and is given by, see, what is the real body and all objects which are surrounding you or nearby you or yourself is a real body. It means black body is a one which is idealized, which emits 100% radiation, which absorbs 100% radiation, is called an ideal body. It is less than 1, anything less than 1, emit or absorptivity less than 1 is called a real body. And it is given by Q is equal to emissivity into the energy of the black body. This is also given as epsilon sigma T to the power of 4. This is in watts per meter square, where E stands for emissivity of the body, black body or real body. It may be, it ranges from 0 to 1. It ranges from 0 to 1. It has no unit. It has no unit as such. It is just a number which indicates the emissivity factor, or we call it as a factor. So, that we are going to study in detail when you are solving problem, where if epsilon emissivity, which lies between 0 and unity, and all real bodies, it is always less than 1. When the heat exchange between two bodies only with a temperature difference, for black body it is sigma T1 to the power of 4 and T2 to the power of 4. For real body, you have to add the emissivity factor, emissivity epsilon there. The equation 5.1.5a, 1.5b, you can see those two, the difference there. It means for the black body, Q is equal to sigma into temperature to the power of 4, and Q is equal to, for real body, it is sigma epsilon into temperature to the power of 4. It means difference, I am telling. So the I'm winding up because my class is going to be closed by 1 o'clock. Now we'll start with some example. So example one, and see, I solved around 10 problems from conduction problem, convection problems, and radiation problems, and I'm trying to explain these numericals which I solved for the examination point of view. So the here one question is asked, determine the heat transfer coefficient, heat transfer H across, heat transfer across 4 meter square material of thickness 6 cm and temperature difference of 100 degrees applied across it. The thermal conductivity of material is 0.08 watts per meter Kelvin or degree Celsius. See, the solution is area is 4 meter square and dx is 6 cm and dt is 100 degree Celsius and K value is given. Just substitute all the values in the given equation, that is Q is equal to minus K dt by dx, conductivity K is 0.08. Why I have taken this 1000 factor below that 4 by 1000, it's supposed to be, that is meter is get converted into centimeter square, because centimeter area is there, that is 6 length is there, that also be converted into meter, and there is a conversion factor, and finally you will get kilojoule per hour energy transmission, because you are multiplying area also, you will get because he has given per hour how much is the thermal energy transmitted from this. You can also go through that and find out the equation. And second problem is that my class is going to wind up because I am exceeding the time limit which is given by. And thank you very much. I'll continue the same class next hour. If I am not able to take any classes, I am going to communicate you in advance. Please bear with me. Thank you very much for patient hearing. Thank you, one and all.